The Washington Post has highlighted the extreme cowardice of Democratic senators who actually voted against expanding federal background checks following the 2012 Sandy Hook shooting. Now they say that they regret their votes. Now, before we get to their statements and their alleged regrets, here's some context into the matter. So in the days leading up to the crucial votes, and this is a piece that was written in May of 2013, so they say last month, but keep in mind that they're referring to legislation that was proposed in early 2013. Votes on the most significant gun control legislation to come before the Senate in nearly two decades, polls showed that about 90% of Americans actually supported background checks for all gun purchases. So the legislation in question back then in early 2013 was really about expanding the federal background check system and closing the loopholes to ensure that anyone who obtains a firearm has to go through that background check, but it didn't pass. When the clerk called the roll, the centerpiece amendment requiring background checks for firearm sales at gun shows through classified ads and on the internet got just 54 yays and 6 votes short of the 60 vote supermajority required. So obviously the legislative filibuster still played a role back then in the Senate. And since they didn't have the 60 votes necessary to pass the legislation, it failed in the Senate. Among the 46 senators who voted to prevent any expansion of background checks, 43 have received help, either direct campaign contributions or independent expenditures from pro-gun interests since 2000. In aggregate, about 8.5 million between the year 2000 and 2013.
That is massively relevant.
That is definitely relevant and certainly played a role in the votes for many of the lawmakers who voted against this legislation. Go ahead.
And I'll add to that something that's never discussed in any of those, even though the Center for Public Integrity, brilliant job there in pointing that out. You don't see that in being covered as much in mainstream media. Anyway, which is that not only can they spend on your behalf and give you campaign contributions, but they could also spend a lot of money against you. Mm-hmm. So that hangs over the heads of the other senators. Even if they don't get money from the NRA, they're worried that their opponent might get millions if they take the wrong vote.
Exactly. So with that all said, let's focus on the both former and current senators that the Washington Post spoke to. Most of them are Democrats. They also spoke to Angus King, I believe. Yes, Angus King from
Maine.
From Maine, who's an independent. So
but caucuses with the Democrats.
Caucuses with the Democrats, exactly. So with that said, the article by Peter Wallsten and Paul Kane in the Washington Post actually begins with a story involving a lobbyist and former Democratic Senator Heidi Heitkamp from North Dakota. They apparently met with Sandy Hook parents in her new office just a few weeks after she took office. So she is newly elected and she meets with lobbyists in favor of some gun control regulations, right? Francine Wheeler, whose 6-year-old child was among the 26 people shot to death at Sandy Hook, including 20 young children, says that she met with Heidi Heitkamp, hoping that she could persuade her to vote in favor of the gun control legislation. Heitkamp was defensive, unkind, and not interested in helping or listening to the stories of our loved ones, added Wheeler of the meeting, in which she petitioned the North Dakota senator to vote for expanding the federal background check system. A lobbyist in the meeting with Wheeler and Heitkamp recalled sitting at the table with her head down after the meeting, and another political consultant told the Post she heard the senator break out into sobs as they left the room. But she voted against the legislation. Now keep in mind that I looked into the campaign spending for her campaign at the time. She actually did not receive money from pro-gun lobbyists, but she did receive money from pro-gun lobbyists after she voted no. We'll get to those numbers in just a moment. But here's what Heitkamp told the Washington Post. Not that I agree with the exact language of these bills, but it was my obligation looking backwards to provide leadership, even though I was there a hot minute, to make those bills better, and I didn't do that. My activity was passive, not active, in searching for a solution, and that I regret. Heitkamp said that she did not recall the meeting with Wheeler, but was extraordinarily sorry for leaving families with the sense that she didn't care about the children who were killed or the experiences of their grieving parents. If any person was left with that impression that I had anything other than the most supreme sympathy and just hurt, that is a failure on my part and I couldn't apologize more, she said. Now again, she voted against.
I think you could.
Yeah, I totally agree. She voted against it. Now Heitkamp of the North Dakota NRA gave her an A+, right? She got an A rating from the NRA. She received no money from gun rights groups. However, that was in 2013. Following 2013, she did receive money from pro-gun groups. 2014, she received $6,000. 2016, she received $2,000. And in 2018, she received $5,000. Not a lot of money, but to be quite frank, I don't think that it was corruption that led to her cowardice here. She's in North Dakota. I think she was terrified of the gun lobby spending money against her in a state that I would venture to say is very pro-gun and friendly toward firearms.
But remember, it's not just Heitkamp. It's over half a dozen senators here who said, "Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry now." So I don't believe any of them. I think they're all callous. I don't think they care about their voters and those kids at all. I don't think they cared back then. I don't think they care now. So number one, there's the issue of the money that we just discussed. And to me, the much larger factor is, are they going to spend a lot of money against me? And you're seeing that now with AIPAC. So AIPAC spent so much money in Democratic Majority for Israel against Nina Turner, Summer Lee, and other progressives that it scared the hell out of cowards like John Fetterman, who then begged them to not, "Oh yeah, I will do everything Israel says, I swear I will." Put out statements like that and then delivered on it so that they wouldn't spend millions of dollars against them in his Senate bid. So that's a factor in the open bribery that we have in America. But the other factor is, of course, public polling, and it depends on which state you're from. And so I of course North Dakota is more pro-gun, she's going to be more concerned about that. But I looked at the assault weapons ban polling and I went back to that time, and Sandy Hook happened in the middle of December of 2012. Last poll, Gallup poll at that time for banning assault weapons was in October of 2011, and it had it at 43 to 53, and then we highlighted the poll they did right after Sandy Hook, okay? And even after Sandy Hook, only 44% were in favor and 51% were against banning it. Nowadays though, mm-hmm. when you look at a Fox News poll, you'll see that it's flipped and 61% are in favor of banning it. Even 36% of Republicans say ban assault weapons.
That's actually really surprising, to be honest with you.
Yeah, wow. And so it went from 43-44 to 61. It went from a minority to a majority, a solid majority. So all of a sudden, Democratic senators found their conscience. So, and the NRA has become a lot less of a factor these days because they basically went bankrupt. They're still in business, they're somehow still getting money, but they're on wobbly legs. So now with less money being spent by the NRA and the polls moving this much, all of a sudden, senators are like, "Oh yeah, I meant I care about dead kids. That's what I meant. I'm so broken up over."
But also for someone like Heitkamp, who's no longer in Congress, she's no longer a senator and doesn't have to worry about re-election. Now she gets to say what she really thinks, how she really feels. And that's the thing that really bothers me. It reminds me of, you know, long ago, House Speaker, Republican House Speaker John Boehner, who was vicious in regard to marijuana policy, wanted to maintain tough on marijuana policies across the country and did not want to reclassify it or take it off of the classification as a Schedule I drug. And then later ended up working in the marijuana industry when he was no longer in Congress.
Of course.
It's just, it's infuriating.
It's all
right?
About power and money.
Yes.
So like we are a rare media. Well, these days we're less rare because the internet exists, right? But mainstream media, they don't tell you that politicians care about money and power when that's number one and number two thing that they care about in life. So that's why, and they treat them with such like honor and respect, etc. Look, at a bare minimum, you can see it in this story, but you see it in many, many stories. The politicians are cowards. So they, which way is the wind going? Oh, which way are my donors going? Which, oh my God, where's the money? Where's the power? So I spare me your crocodile tears. You either vote the right way when the issue's on the line, or you don't. So don't come back to me a decade later and go, well, now it's beneficial to my political career or my lobbyist career to pretend I would have voted the right way and I feel bad about it.
Yeah.
No, those same exact cowards will vote in the next bill, whichever bill it is, whether it's about gun control or something else, and they'll vote with their donors. And then they'll say a decade later, oh, golly, gee, did I vote against lower wages? Did I vote against universal health care coverage?
Yeah.
Well, did I vote for higher drug prices? Oh, I really regret it. Wink.
Yeah.
You're not regretting it now when you're taking the cash from those industries.
Yeah, no cookies for you. Let's just put it that way.
100%.
And let's name names. The other lawmakers, former lawmakers that Washington Post spoke to included Mark Begich of Alaska. He took no money from gun rights groups, but was also probably terrified by his constituents. And Mark Udall from Colorado, he also expressed regrets over his votes following Sandy Hook. But there were current senators that they spoke to as well. You guys are currently senators and you could change things around. And that included Michael Bennet, who did not take any gun money, Martin Heinrich, who we'll hear from in just a moment, Angus King and Mark Warner, all of them said they regret their vote in 2013. Now Heinrich, a lifelong gun owner and hunter, said that after the Parkland massacre, his son Carter, then in high school, joined other young people in demanding new gun laws at the March for Our Lives, at March for Our Lives on the National Mall. And he says, when your kid tells you you're wrong with that much conviction, you need to stop and think about it, he said.
Yeah, that's nonsense.
Less thinking, more doing.
Yeah, that's total horse crap. None of that is true. So maybe his kid marched, that's fine, right? But like, this is how you make decisions as a grown-up, you're a United States Senator. Mike, you know, my kid said he wanted the latest PlayStation with such conviction, it changed my mind. No, this is all theater, guys. It's all about the money and the power and the polling, etc. It has nothing to do with this. He talked to his kids and his kids talked him into it? You're a US senator, your kids talked you into it. Get out of here. It's all bull crap, whatever, you get it.
If you enjoyed this video, that's because of our members. They make us independent, they make us strong, and they make us honest. Become a member today by hitting the join button below.